Well, Merry Christmas. My name is Jeff Thompson. I get the privilege of serving as one of the pastors here. I'm so excited about the opportunity to get into God's Word and to celebrate this Christmas season. You know, we talk so much about gifts, and even on the car ride this morning to church, my kids were still arguing over, this is the number one thing I want from Santa, and this is, and I really want, one of my sons wants a dirt bike, so you can keep asking for Santa for that. But, you know, kids especially are so into gifts. They're so into, like, what's in the box? And when the Amazon packages arrive at our house, they're like, what is that? You know, and they're hiding up on the shelf and all of those sorts of things. But they're so into the gifts. And I think many of us, we have different ways of opening gifts and of actually getting it what's in the box. I don't know if you've seen this. Kids are especially that way because they have absolutely no filter at all. But even us as adults, you know, some people would like carefully open maybe an X-Acto knife. You know, I might want to save this packaging for later. I'll fold it nicely. I'm going to just be very careful about the way that I open this gift. And others are going to open the box, and they're going to take the toy out and get that plastic stuff all off of it and put the batteries in and start playing with the toy immediately before moving on to the next present. And other kids, like all three of mine, really, would destroy the package. There would be no remnant of box left. We would be finding elements of the wrapping paper under the couch for like a month because they've just destroyed the thing, and then on to the next gift, and on to the next gift, and on to the, and frantic because they're so excited about all of those kind of things, because different people respond to gifts in different ways. And that's okay. But every gift requires a response. For each one of us, whether you tear the quickly, or whether you take the packaging and fold it nicely and stick it in your bag for later, each one of us needs to respond to a gift in a certain way. And my prayer for our time in God's Word isn't that we would learn how to use an X-Acto knife to open a gift carefully. It's that we would all be moved to respond to the gift that's given to us in Jesus Christ this Christmas season. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful for your incredible gift of your Son. And God, we come to this season every single year, and every year we talk about the gift of Jesus. And Lord, I pray that you would renew us afresh to be reminded of the reality of what Jesus has done for us, to be in wonder and in amazement of all that you've done for us, Lord, that we would be transformed because of this gift that's given to us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, go ahead and grab your Bible. Turn over to Luke chapter 2. We are doing a Christmas series here for this week and next week, and we're calling the series Unto You. We're going through the book, or the chapter Luke 2. This week, we'll be looking at verses 1 through 21, and then next week, Pastor Dave Stone will be sharing with us for the rest of the chapter and looking at some of the details of Luke 2. I would encourage you to spend some time this week, if you don't have an Advent calendar or anything like that that you're already reading through, spend some time in Luke 2 this week knowing some of these truths, because this is a very familiar story to us. But let's begin reading in verse 1 of chapter 2. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. Now while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. This is a familiar story. Back in Luke 1, we see that the angel Gabriel appears to Mary and announces this miraculous birth, that although she's a virgin, she's going to give birth to a son. This incredible son who will be Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And as of his kingdom, there will be no end. So here they are. having to leave their hometown of Nazareth because of this census, this decree that's gone out, and they're making this trek. So Joseph pulls out his iPhone and pulls out Google Maps, and he looks that this is a 33-hour walk. It's pretty crazy in and of itself. Like, we take a lot of road trips, you know, down to Florida. It's like 19 hours with three kids in the car. It's a little crazy, but like, this was walking, and, you know, Mary was probably on a donkey for most of it, walking very slowly, and she's pregnant, like, very pregnant. You know, like, if you've ever been around a pregnant woman around, like, 8, 9 months, they're like, get this kid out of me right now. I'm uncomfortable to sleep. I'm uncomfortable to eat. I can't sit. I can't walk. I can't do anything. I'm just, get this kid out of me. That's kind of what Mary is probably feeling like. And she's having to walk 33 hours to get to this place because some dude wants to take a census. That's actually what's happening. So I just feel cranky for her in all of this. We don't see what her attitude is and all that, but I know what my attitude would be in that. But here they are, pulling up Google Maps, going on this long walk, walking through all of these things, and then instead of a private room at Prentice Hospital with a great view of the lakefront, they end up in the barn. That's what it says here. They're in the barn because there's no room for them in the inn, no private room. This newborn baby boy, this king of the world, is placed in a feeding trough. And as the Son of the Most High is being placed in this feeding trough, the world is given good news of great joy. Let's look at verse 8. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all of the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." This good news of great joy is given in such an unexpected way. And that's because the good news is a message for all. It's a message for all. These shepherds that are receiving this word from the angels, they're the common, the working class people. I think lots of times we think like, ooh, these stinky shepherds, and everybody looked down on them. That's not actually what happened back then. They were seen as like the blue collar, hard workers. It wasn't a particularly glorious job. These guys have the night shift, so I don't know what all of that means. But they're just the hardworking, salt of the earth type people. They're regular people. It was just like any other night shift that they have worked, checking on their sheep, making sure that they have enough food, keeping their eyes open for predators, and suddenly an angel of the Lord appears. Now we think of this story, we hear about Christmas, we're like, yeah, the angel, I got that at the top of my tree. Uh-huh, yeah, the angel, I got it. It's on Christmas cards, and sometimes it's on little coffee cups and all of those sorts of things. We treat it as like this normal thing, but in all of God's word, stretching over thousands and thousands of years, there are only 18 occurrences of an angel appearing to someone. That's as far as we know in all of history, is an angel appears 18 times. So this is a very rare time. Many, many of these are surrounding the birth of Jesus Christ. And every single one of them, the response is the same. What's their response? It's fear. Every single time an angel meets with a person, it's fear. Here it says that they are filled with fear, or if you want to quote Charlie Brown, they were sore afraid. They're filled with fear because Hebrews 10:31 says, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. And so when they come face to face with something that's otherworldly, their immediate and natural response is to fear. But the angel here says, fear not. We see this 300 times in the Bible where somebody's saying, fear not, fear not. But the angel says this. Now, why are they not supposed to fear? This is the interactive part. Why are they not supposed to fear? Look at the text. It's good news. It's like, whoo, okay, good news. It's like your boss walks into your office like, we need to talk. And you're like, oh, no. Don't be afraid. It's good news. Oh, good. Okay, I'm getting a raise. You know, whatever it is. So he has good news for them. So you can see these guys kind of relax, like, okay, all right. I'm still a little freaked out. Not sure what this angel's doing here. But at least he says it's good news. And he says this message will be for all the people. It's beautiful to me that this came to regular people, this miraculous and unexpected occurrence that's happening here. These angels showing up to talk to these guys, to give this great news, it just comes to regular people. And he says, this message is for all the people. Man, I found so much comfort in that this week, that it didn't come to those of high status. It didn't come to those of priestly line or of high religious status. It didn't come to those who like seemed like they had everything put together. It just came to regular guys, just these regular people out in the field doing their job, working hard. It came to regular people, and it came to regular people to display that God's good news of great joy is to be received and experienced by all. Not just those who have thousands of followers on Instagram. Not just those who are wealthy or seem to have everything together or seem like they're good. But God's message of good news came for all of us. Maybe that's because those of us who are regular and don't have a lot of Instagram followers, we realize that we're in need, that I can't do this on my own, that there's nothing special about me, but these angels show up to give this incredible message of good news to people who recognize their need. I don't know if I look for any opportunity to talk about coffee that I can. Pastor Ed and I have this ongoing, like, joking feud. He likes hot cocoa a lot. And so if you ever hear him say that I like hot cocoa, it is a lie. It is a lie. Coffee is the it's from heaven. So I don't know if you noticed, but we just last week we switched our coffee provider. So we have some nice little cups. They're stamped, the little thing. There's a little sign down there. We used to be using a couple local companies, and they were great coffee. But we're now using a company called I Have a Bean, which, granted, I don't think should win any competition for advertising just based on that name. But it's an incredible company. I love them. It's a Christian company. They're located out of Wheaton, West Chicago area. They have really, really good coffee, and I'm a coffee snob, if you know me. So it's really good stuff. But the one thing that I really love about this, because there's lots of places in this city where you could go and have incredible coffee, but their whole mission, it's a not-for-profit organization, their whole mission is to take people who are post-prison and to give them an opportunity for a fresh start, an opportunity for a new life. So these people who've been in prison before, they're the ones who roast all the beans. They're the ones who work in the plant. They're the ones who work in the office, all so that they can give a fresh start to people who are coming out of prison. And it's a beautiful thing. All of their resources go to that. We get bags of coffee, and it'll say, like, roasted by David. And it's like, David actually did that. And he's a guy who used to be in, I've never met David, but he used to be in prison. And this company is giving him an opportunity where a lot of places wouldn't before. And so we've loved the fact that we're spending less money, actually, than we were on some of our other coffee. And we're able to get better coffee, I think. And better than that, it supports a Christian ministry that has a great cause. And so if you want to support them downstairs, you can find them online. They sell bags of coffee and things like that too, but hopefully you'll like the new coffee. But all of that is because we want to give back to people. We want the things that we're doing already to be able to help people. And you know, the people who come out of a prison, they recognize that they're in need. They don't feel like they have it all together. And so often we can feel like, well, I'm wearing clean clothes today, and I picked out a nice jacket that I got for $19 at H&M. And we work really hard to like put on our best face for everyone. But God's good news comes to regular people. It comes for all of us. Wherever we are, whatever we've done in the past, God's good news meet us there. Your past choices don't determine your future reality. Where you came from doesn't determine where you will end up. What you do doesn't rule over what's already been done for you in this message of good news. Your fear can't eclipse his joy because his good news of great joy is for all the people. It's for all of us. And this good news of great joy is for us to receive. It's a message for all, and it's a peace to receive. Verse 13 says, "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.' When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us.'" These heavenly hosts, so you get this picture. So there's the shepherds, a single angel shows up, and they're like, "Ah!" They're afraid. They give this good news, and then the sky opens. I mean, it's really hard to even picture this. The sky opens, and it just says, what does it say? "With the angel, a multitude of heavenly host." So the Greek here means a whole lot. It's a whole lot of people, a whole lot of these angels who are all in front of them. I mean, I got to think that fear might have escalated a little bit, even though they heard the good news and are excited about this. Just, what in the world? But that's what they're seeing. But this peace, they're declaring that there's peace among those with whom he is pleased. The peace isn't just a cessation of strife. It's just not like, no more fighting. That's not what it's talking about here. It's all of the blessings that come with the giving of Messiah for us. And this peace is received by all whom God is pleased. So the question that it has us when we read this text, the question for us is he pleased with me? If it's for everybody that God is pleased for, I want the peace. I want the peace. Now, is he pleased with me? Well, Hebrews 11:6 says, "Without faith, it is impossible to please God." So faith is the pathway in which I receive the peace of God, because that is how God is pleased with me. Faith in Jesus Christ, because John 1:12 says, "But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God." The way God is pleased with us is through our faith, through our declaration of faith in Jesus Christ, that his death and burial and resurrection on my behalf, that's payment for my sin. That's how we get the peace. We turn from our sins and we embrace Jesus Christ by faith, and God's peace is given to us. Not just the baby in the manger, but the Savior on the cross and the King on the throne. This peace is the forgiveness of our sins. It's all the things that you have ever done are washed away. Anything that you could do in the future that's against the Lord, it's been forgiven already because he's paid for that. It's the you can cease striving, because God's taken care of it. There's incredible peace in that. You can stop all of those wondering and stressing and where am I going to end up and what's it going to be like and what's life going to be like and all that. You can let all of that go and receive his peace. It's offered to all of us, but it must be received by each one of us. The angels heralded it. The shepherds heard it. The heavenly host declared it. The shepherds then carried it. Do you receive it? Have you turned from your sins and trusted Jesus Christ by faith? If you have, his peace is available to you. It's yours through this good news of great joy. It's a peace that we receive, and it's also a choice to treasure. It's a choice that we make to treasure. Let's pick up reading again in verse 16. "And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured up all of these things, pondering them in their heart." It's a choice that we make to treasure. A number of years ago, we set out and made a short film called The Shepherd. And I want to show you a little clip of that that shows this encounter happening. So let's turn our attention to the screen for a moment.
His name, Emmanuel.
Tell someone.
We must tell everyone.
We must tell everyone.
Everyone. Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
We've waited for this for so long. So long.
His arm. His arm.
His arm.
His arm.
Yes, his arm.
Oh, it's okay.
Well, I love that message, and that's something that our church put together with Dallas Jenkins. You can actually find that whole video. It's the pilot for his Chosen series. You can find the whole video on YouTube if you want to watch that this Christmas season. It's so powerful. And one of the things that I love about this encounter, this clip, is that the text, the shepherds went with haste, like right away. They hear this message, and you see them at the beginning of that video running to the place to see what has been told to them. I love the immediate response, the sense of urgency. If you know me, like, these are my guys. No sitting around talking about, like, let's come up with a strategy of how we should get there. It's just, let's get there. Let's go. Right now. let's go. And I love their haste. I love their urgency. I love their response over and over. We must tell someone. We must tell everyone. And then his response at the end, people must know. They must know this message of good news. It's our job to go with haste and to carry this message. I love to see the choices that each of the different people in this text make. The shepherds, first they hear, but they go about and they share it. This message is for you, but it's not just for you. People must know. And our job is to carry this message, this good news of great joy to the world that's all around us. This, you'll see the word "and" in verse 20 that links Mary's response and the shepherd's response, showing that both of these, although they're different, they're adequate, they're appropriate, and they're positive responses. They're different ways of opening the present, but they're both getting at what's inside. But then you see, in contrast, the people wonder. This is amazement along the lines of like, what in the world is this all about? They're sort of scratching their heads, not sure what to think about this unique situation. They're wondering, but Mary's pondering. This is the thinking deeply about it and almost meditating on it or chewing on it. That's what Mary is doing here. Like, have you ever sat at a light? You're sitting at this red light and just kind of zoned out, just really thinking deeply about something that's going on in your life, and then the guy behind you like honks to let you know, like, oh, you know, whatever. I'm usually the guy honking. Sorry, I'm a little impatient sometimes. Maybe it's the going with haste thing. I don't know. But it's even worse if you're like, you're sitting at the red light and you're kind of pondering, thinking, and then you look up and it's a yellow light. That's when it's really bad because you've sat there a whole cycle. This happens sometimes, but it's this pondering, this thinking it through, this idea of like, Lord, what in the world are you up to here? Just treasuring these things. That's what she's doing. How are you pondering? How are you treasuring up this gospel message, this good news of great joy this year? Are you more concerned with your Amazon Prime packages being stolen off of your porch? Are you more concerned with the people that you know and love hearing this message of good news of great joy, maybe for the first time, really? Them really grasping it. Don't allow the craziness of the season to eclipse our concern for all of those we come in contact with to hear this message of a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And we're saying unto you, it's good news of great joy. Unto the angels, they brought the good news. And unto the shepherds, they responded to the good news. And unto others, they were wondering about the good news. Unto Mary, they treasured the good news. But unto you, what is it unto you? What is this good news to you? How will you respond to the gift that's been given to you? This is a story that so many recognize, even in our culture, but it's a Savior that so few actually treasure. Do you choose to treasure the good news of great joy this Christmas season? To hold it as valuable, to see it as the most significant reality in your life? Do you choose to treasure it? Because if you do, this good news of great joy is finally a reason to praise. It's a reason to praise. Look down at verse 20 and 21. And the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen as it had been told them. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. You see, not only did the shepherds see this as such an important message that they needed to receive and needed to share, their immediate response was to worship God. God's message in Jesus calls us to a response. God's testimony concerning Christ's birth, it should cause us to believe in him, to receive it, and to rejoice in him. Psalm 32:1 says, blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Notice back in verse 13, we brushed through it really quickly, but it says, when the angel brings the good news, it says there's this multitude of heavenly hosts praising God. Through the darkness of the night watch was met with the glory of the Lord shining around them. A few ordinary men were met with a multitude of heavenly hosts. The silence of the Judean countryside was met with the shout of many angels. You see, when you understand this good news of great joy, our appropriate response is to worship the Lord who has sent this good news. We worship Him because our waiting is over. We worship Him because God's promise is here to us. We worship Him because Emmanuel has come. We worship because my sins have been forgiven. We worship Him because our King came in humility, and we worship Him because He is exalted over all. Philippians 2 says, though He was in the form of God, He did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but He emptied Himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him and bestowed on Him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Amen.